I'm super excited to welcome Melissa Hartwig to Politics and Prose tonight. She's a titan of the wellness world and has helped literally millions of people change how they eat. So it's like pretty crazy and awesome to have her here in this space with all of you. I hope you guys are excited too. She's a certified sports nutritionist who specializes in helping people change their relationship with food and create lifelong healthy habits, and is the co-creator of the Whole30 program. She's here tonight to discuss her new books, Whole30 Fast and Easy, a cookbook full of appealing, simple, and unfussy recipes, and Whole30 Day by Day, a handbook of tips and advice and resources. What I love the most about her approach is the grounding reminder that there are truly hard things in life, like having cancer or losing a parent, and changing your diet to improve your life is not one of them. We tell ourselves all kinds of stories about why we can't eat better or get to the gym more, and Melissa's message cuts through all of that and challenges us to be our best selves. Melissa will be in conversation with David Leonhardt, a Pulitzer Prize-winning op-ed columnist and associate editorial page editor at the New York Times. Please join me in welcoming Melissa and David.
Please only refer to me as her titaness going forward. Thank you. That was amazing.
Thank you all for coming. So I got to start with a quick funny story, which is Washingtonian magazine has a guide of things to do in Washington. And there were two items for today, things to do in Washington. This was one of them. Come here, Melissa Woo-hoo. Hartwig. The other was that today was No Pants Metro Ride.
Oh my gosh, I'm so torn right now, you guys.
So I first would like to thank those of you who skipped No Pants Metro Ride for being here instead. And I would also like to thank those of you who participated for putting on pants before you came. We are grateful. This is a really exciting event for me to do because I am a Whole30 devotee. And so it's just really exciting to be here with Melissa. And I'm sure many of you feel that way as well.
I'm very excited. Thank you. My mom is very excited.
So let's start with the second part of Whole30, the number 30, implies that it is not something you do all the time, not permanently. And so I think it'd be great if you could give everyone sort of a sense of what do you do when you're not on the 30 part of Whole30? What is your day-to-day eating like?
I wish every media outlet who said the Whole30 is so restrictive that it is unsustainable understood that the 30 and 30 means that you're not doing it 365. But it is meant to be a short-term dietary experiment to help you figure out how the foods you are eating are impacting you in your unique individual context. And once you do this experiment of pulling stuff out, adding it back in, and comparing your experience, you then take the information you've learned and use it to create the perfect diet for you, what I call food freedom. So I don't eat Whole30 all the time. I eat according to the principles that I've learned over my 7 or 8 Whole30s, my dozen of mini Whole30 resets in between, and all of this kind of continued trial and error when I'm reintroducing foods that are not Whole30 compliant. So how I eat doesn't say anything about how you should eat. Just because white rice for me and my sushi is okay for me doesn't mean it's okay for you. Just because a Justin's peanut butter cup is worth it for me doesn't mean it's worth it for you. So anytime someone says, how do you eat? I'm always a little bit careful about how I phrase that because I don't want you to think this is prescriptive. The idea of it is food freedom. You get to decide for yourself. But day to day, I eat mostly Whole30-ish because I know that's how I look and feel my best with the stuff that I've reintroduced and realized are totally fine for me. So white rice on my sushi, the occasional hummus, sometimes a glass of white wine, sometimes a Justin's peanut butter cup. And I know exactly how often and how much I can get away with and still look and feel exactly as awesome as I want to look and feel. And that's what my food freedom diet looks like.
The thing you mentioned, hummus, the one part of the diet that I found the most counterintuitive was actually legumes, right? The idea that this thing that feels like it's so healthy. I think Ron Artest, the NBA player, former NBA player, once referred to beans as the total package, right? Because they're nutritious and they're healthy. What concerns do you have about legumes and why are they outside the...
So I think some of the, when people get hung up on a specific food group, like, oh, but legumes are so healthy or whole grains are so heart healthy, the first thing I like to remind them is we're not saying these foods are bad. I'm not saying these foods are bad and that you should never eat them. I'm saying, according to the scientific literature and our clinical experience, which now spans almost 10 years, These foods are commonly problematic to varying degrees across a broad range of people, and you won't know if they're problematic for you until you eliminate them and put them back in. So legumes are probably the least offensive offenders, right? We evaluate foods based on four categories: your cravings and emotional relationship with food, your metabolism and hormonal balance, your digestion and your immune system. I don't know anyone who has an unhealthy relationship with lentils. Nobody comes home after a hard day at work and like buries themselves in a face of black beans, right? So probably that's like not gonna be an issue. Although peanut butter, how many people can go house on a jar of peanut butter? Mm-hmm. You know, but what we see tends to be digestive issues related to the FODMAPs in legumes, maybe some of the soy, but in particular is one of the most allergenic foods, one of the top eight allergenic foods. Peanuts in the medical literature are known to actually cross the gut barrier and engage with the immune system, which may be why we have so many incidents of peanut allergies. So they're probably the least offensive of these offenders, but as part of this big picture protocol, pull them out, put them back in, see how they work for you.
So I think we're in this period in American politics, in American society, when people disagree about almost everything, except on both sides and in the middle, I think people feel pretty down about what's going on in the country. I actually feel optimistic about our eating habits as a country. If you look at the data on sugar consumption, if you look at the data on soda consumption, we still aren't eating well, to be clear. We're eating terribly. But we seem to have perhaps turned a corner. That if you look, I mean, I believe soda consumption has fallen more than 20% over the last decade or so. So from your perspective, do you share that optimism? And whether you share it or not, from a societal perspective, thinking even beyond Whole30, what do you think we need to do as a society to start eating better and have a healthier relationship with food so it doesn't feel punitive to eat better?
So I am optimistic. And the reason I'm optimistic is because this event last year had about 250 people, and this event this year has like closer to 500 people, right? So I'm seeing more and more people coming into this idea of eating healthy, not as a punishment, not as a chore, not as even a weight loss initiative. That's the hugest thing I'm seeing change. People are so over this yo-yo weight loss diet cycle. Like, just can you just talk to me about something other than the scale and acknowledge that I want more for my life than just fitting into a pair of pants. I want to feel better. I want more energy for my kids. I want to sleep better. I want to have these like aches and pains go away. I want to be there for my grandkids and be more present and be more energetic. So I do see a lot of kind of coming from the community perspective. I also see it coming on the other side from the brand and the food perspective. I have seen this year alone three major companies, Applegate, Zupanoma, DNX Bar, specifically change their product formulas to suit you, your community, this community, the Whole30 community, which is enormous and I feel like unprecedented. So I think companies are listening to the idea that we don't want added sugar in our stuff. We don't want these additives. We don't want these preservatives. We want real healthy food. From a big picture perspective, I think if we brought two things back into our lives, it would go a huge way towards getting us in general to eat better. I think if we learned how to cook, and we cooked more together as a family, and I think if we dined together more often, where it was this relaxed social experience instead of eating alone in our car on the way to work or on the way home from work, I think those two things would go a huge way towards getting all of us just eating more real food in general.
One of the things that I thought about when my family and I were doing Whole30 was it takes a substantial amount of time, as you're talking about, much of which is really quite pleasant and lovely, but it does take time. And it also takes some money, right? Unfortunately, produce, meats, these are expensive, right? What advice do you have? And I feel like there's probably some larger implications here. What advice do you have for people who don't have as much money and as much time as many of us who are here are lucky enough to have? How can you either do Whole30 or improve your diet when really you are living hour to hour and paycheck to paycheck?
This is what's so challenging, because when I talk to my community and they say, you know, the people who are here tonight or the people who are on Instagram and they say, I don't have, you know, I'm kind of strapped or I don't have the financial resources, the first question I ask them is like, do you have the new iPhone? Because if you do, maybe it's just a matter of prioritizing. But when you're looking at, honestly, people who are living paycheck to paycheck, who are worried about making sure that they can keep the roof over their heads and their kids in clothes, it's very difficult to argue with the idea that fast food is less expensive. One of the things we've been trying really hard to do is make the Whole30 more accessible by highlighting. For example, we have a Whole30 certified coach. Her name is Sarah Rentfro. Her entire mission is, how do you do Whole30 shopping only at Walmart and Aldi? I love that. I think, you know, the idea that everything should be grass-fed and pastured and organic and come from your local farmer and your almonds need to be roasted in unicorn fat and hand-shelled by Spanish virgins, like, I love the idea if you have the capacity of making sure that you know where your food is coming from, but you don't have to do that to do Whole30 and reap the benefits. You can do frozen food, you can do CSAs, you can do the Ugly Fruit. Hungry Harvest, which is based here in DC, is an amazing CSA that takes that recycled ugly fruit that nobody wants to buy at the grocery store and turns it into a cost-effective CSA for people who are looking to eat healthier and have budgetary concerns. So I think there are ways to do it, and we're trying really hard to expand our kind of inclusion to help people get to that point where absolutely anybody who wants to can do the Whole30 for 30 days and then apply what they've learned to their individual context.
What are some of the most cost, what are some of the cheapest Whole30 friendly foods? Like, just sort of, if we think about a few.
Yeah, eggs are one of the most cost effective. I think you can still find really good sales on eggs at your local grocery store. I think in season, vegetables and fruit are really cost effective. So if you're buying, you know, $8 grapes from Chile in the middle of winter, that's probably not as effective, but you can find the stuff that's in season far more reasonably. And like I said, a CSA is a great option. I think you can skip, like, nuts and seeds tend to be very expensive, and there are actually healthier fat options. So you can do things like buying in bulk at Costco. You can do things like avocado when they're on sale. Going through and, like, looking through your actual grocery store circular for things that are on sale and shopping according to, like, when your produce gets delivered can be a really helpful tip. So I think there are a lot of hacks you can do. Frozen seafood, frozen vegetables, frozen fruits can be very cost effective. Tinned meat or canned meat can be very cost effective. I think there are a lot of things that you can do to put a Whole30 meal plan together on a real shoestring budget.
Yep. Many of us either are or are related to vegetarians or vegans now. And so I know you've given that some real thought, right? That there are ways to do this. You can do the whole program if you're vegetarian or vegan, but you can also do a tweaked version of it. Could you talk about that for a couple minutes?
So the Whole30 wasn't designed for vegans, right? It's like it's not designed for vegans because if you pull out everything we're asking you to pull out, what's left to eat is not enough to keep you healthy for 30 days. It's like vegetables, fruit, nuts, and seeds. What I've wanted to do, though, is make sure that nobody feels excluded. And I think there are some really important pieces of the Whole30 framework, this idea of foods that are typically problematic and pulling them out and putting them back in, improving your habits, improving your emotional relationship with food that can be applied in that construct. So there are recommendations in the Whole30 book for how to do the program if you are vegetarian, meaning you'll eat fish and eggs, but that's it. It might be a boring 30 days, but the benefit of it is that you get to evaluate the plant-based protein sources that you might want to put back in your food freedom and see which work best for you. If you're a vegan, I've outlined a full vegan reset in Food Freedom Forever. So it's applying the Whole30 framework and the spirit and the intention of the program to that particular context where you're pulling out stuff that's the most likely to be problematic in a vegan diet. We're making recommendations to kind of make sure that your macronutrients are balanced and you're getting as many micronutrients as possible. So I think there are, and we have a very supportive community centered around that too. There are articles on our website and there's an entire section in the Whole30 forum devoted to vegans and vegetarians who want to join the Whole30 community. So we try to be very welcoming and inclusive while understanding that if you're doing the Whole30 and you're adding in some plant-based protein, it's not the Whole30, but that doesn't mean you can't be part of our community and get the support and benefit from what the program's framework has to offer.
What about socializing? In some ways, it was actually the hardest thing for me the first time that I did it, which was my wife and I would be going out to dinner with friends, and I felt like I had to give them a 10-minute lecture before we got there. And I knew, I just thought, I'm doing something wrong here.
Like you had
right?
to prepare them for what you were about
them,
to order?
Right, like what if they were going to cook, right? If these were, some people knew Whole30, and we'd just say we're doing Whole30, and then that was easy. But other people didn't, and they'd say, well, what about if we made this? And I would say, no. And so I'm sure you've heard many people kind of talk about this, particularly maybe if you're dealing with older generations who aren't who might think this is a totally crazy idea, right? And so what advice do you give about that?
So the first thing I'd say is you've got to come up with a really concise but very personal elevator pitch for what the Whole30 is and why you are doing it. So if you're, you know, you invite me to dinner at your house and I go, okay, but I'm doing this thing and I can't eat any pasta and I can't eat any bread and I can't eat any of this and I can't have any wine, you're going to go, okay, I don't know what to cook you. Here's some kale. Like, right. Okay. But if I say to you, okay, I would love to come for dinner. I'm doing this 30-day experiment. I've been having problems with my allergies and my cravings. And so I'm doing this experiment to figure out if some foods may be impacting this. I'm eating a lot of meat, seafood, eggs, vegetables, and fruit. Can we just have a really simple meal based around that? That sounds much more accessible. And then maybe you might ask some questions. I could give you some specifics. Or maybe I just invite you to my house for dinner and I cook you a Whole30 meal and nobody would ever look at that and think this is some weird, crazy diet. Not with our recipes. So I think that's a big thing. The most important thing I want to stress, though, is I don't want you to become a Whole30 hermit. It may be easier the first like few days of the program if you're feeling like your commitment is a little tenuous to avoid the like happy hour or the wine tasting invitation or something that you know it's going to be really difficult to keep you on track. But going forward, I want you to get the stress alleviating benefits of in-person social interaction. And I want you to learn how to talk to friends and family about your new healthy habits, because ideally this is what the rest of your life is going to look like. You're going to be paying attention to your food and changing the way you eat so that you're eating in a way that's healthiest for you. And if you turn into this person who can't go out and see people because you're on the Whole30, you have zero chance of getting anybody else in your life on the Whole30, right? So I want you to lead by example, take advantage of the social benefits of that in-person connection, but also learn how to live your life with bridal showers and weddings and family dinners. Because if you learn something from the Whole30 and your diet changes as a result, you're going to want to make sure that that's sustainable. And it's not sustainable with you eating every meal by yourself at home.
I would add that a club soda with a little slice of lime in a social setting looks identical to a cocktail.
You
don't get any questions if
it
you're
does.
Holding that.
Absolutely, yes. We have a big fan of LaCroix and lime.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exercise is not a part of the statutory Whole30, but it's clearly tightly connected to it in the larger sense. Do you have thoughts about, are there lessons from Whole30 in terms of human behavior that apply to exercise? Are there advice you would give people about starting an exercise regimen based on all that you've learned from changing eating habits?
I think, you know, I really love studying habit research and the psychology of change and willpower, addiction, and recovery. That's kind of my jam. I think there are some very overarching concepts. What helps you succeed with Whole30 is going to help you succeed with any other habit change, whether that be exercise or starting a meditation practice or what have you. Staying very closely connected to the process is a very important part of beginning and maintaining a new healthy habit. That's why Whole30 Day by Day is so, I think, is going to be so helpful, because every single day you're staying connected to the process, you're tracking your progress, it's guiding you to think about what's positively changing in your life, it's reminding you of your growth mindset that I'm a healthy person with healthy habits, it's providing you with some accountability. So if you can take that same idea of staying connected to the process and apply it to an exercise regimen, whether it's getting an accountability buddy, signing up for a 30-day boot camp challenge at your local gym, journaling your exercise routine, that can be very helpful. Planning and preparation is a huge part of the Whole30, right? Planning to succeed. One of the things that got me into my gym habit a million years ago was every night before I went to bed, I laid my entire outfit out for the next morning. So I had my pants, I had my shirt, I had my socks, everything right down to my underwear, everything. I laid it all out nice and neat. And then I told myself all I had to do in the morning was get up and put the clothes on. If I didn't feel like going to the gym, I didn't have to. All I had to do was put the clothes on. Well, you know, when you're in like a cute little outfit with some tights and some sneakers, you feel kind of silly lying around at the house. So I invariably would go to the gym. But creating these planning and prep steps and these little triggers to remind you to kind of get ingrained in this new habit can be a very helpful step. Having the in-person social support can be incredibly helpful. So again, maybe this person isn't going to the gym with you, but maybe you're talking to your best friend every day about what did you do at the gym today, or did you go to your yoga class today, or I really don't feel like going today. And it's like, okay, what's going on in your life that you're feeling either stressed or anxious about it? And maybe talking through some of the emotional route. All of those things apply to you being successful at your Whole30, but you can carry them over into any healthy habit you're trying to build or sustain going forward.
It reminds me of the advice that you give that don't just start Whole30 cold. Have a whole bunch of food in the house. Be ready to do it, right? In some ways, that's similar to the idea of getting the clothes out in the morning, that if you want to try to change habits, you got to make it easier on yourself.
You
right?
do. Exactly. You do. And, you know, if you look at the stages of change where it's like pre-contemplation and then contemplation and then preparation and then action, most people fail because they go right from contemplation. I think I need a change. There's this Whole30. I'm going to do the Whole30. I'm starting in 5 minutes. And you skip preparation. And then you kind of set yourself up to fail, right? Because you're not fully prepared physically, psychologically, emotionally for what you're about to encounter. I would rather you take that week in between and like really plan, like over plan, over prepare, so that when you get into that first day of this new habit, you feel like you're totally ready to go.
You have food in the house. You also have some things that you're actually looking forward to, yeah. right? Whether it's recipes from your book or whether it's a Whole30 recipe from someplace else. You're saying, oh my goodness, I'm going to have this big fat steak on day three of it. And then you're looking forward
Absolutely.
To it. Absolutely. What have you heard? I'm sure a fair number of people who do it are parents who have children who aren't necessarily up for doing it, right? And so, but that's tricky, right? Because if you're a parent and you've got a kid noshing next to you on some big hunk of bread, it may not be exactly what you want to see, particularly. What's the worst day of Whole30, the hardest?
10 days, 10 and 11, the yeah. hardest days.
So 10 and 11, you don't really want to see the kid or next to you.
Or like 5, 6, kill all the things. Don't bring bread near me and kill all the things.
So I assume you don't say the kids need to do it too, but I assume in some cases they do. What's the kind of range of successful strategies when the parents want to do it? Or maybe you would say, look, it's just better to have the whole family do it.
It's hard because I don't have a lot of street cred here because I have a 5-year-old, but he's never had anything that, like, he doesn't do anything other than Whole30. Like, he's had some white rice, but that's because he was stealing my sushi. Like, he doesn't, I've never had to transition him.
Right.
But we do have, we've had someone on the Whole30 team who transitioned her kids very successfully from a very standard American diet into a Whole30 diet. I think it kind of depends on a couple things. One, it depends on your dynamic as a family. If it were my mom would have said, I'm cooking what I'm cooking and you're going to eat it or you're not. And that's it. Like, there was no discussion. If that's the relationship you have with your kids, maybe that's the answer. It's, this is what I'm cooking. And if you want to like go to your friend's house and eat some Cheerios or some whatever, like fine. But when you're in my house, this is what you're eating. Maybe it's having a discussion up front about like mom and dad are going to do this. And like, we're going to, you know, kind of overlap the foods that we know you like that are also Whole30, but I'm gonna, you know, cook you some of this other stuff to make sure that you're happy and healthy, and we'll try it first and then see if it's something that you want to do. Invariably, if the parents are doing it, the kids are at least partially doing it. It's like almost impossible for them not to. It's very, very difficult on the parent to like, and I talked to someone last night at Cincinnati. She was like, I make 5 different meals because all my kids eat very differently and I'm doing it, my husband's not doing it. And I was like, oh, that would not fly in my house, but you know. Maybe that's your dynamic. What I have to remind people of is that however you choose to do it, whether you choose to jump all in with your kids because you know your kids are like an all or nothing, they can handle it, whether you choose to baby step them or whether you just leave them out of this round entirely, you have to remember as a parent that you are doing this for you. This is your thing. It's not for them. It's not for your husband. This is for you. And by default, you will be a better parent. You will be a better wife. You'll be a better partner or a spouse. But you're doing this for you. So yes, it can be tempting to see the kids eating mac and cheese or the bread, but like that stuff isn't special. You can have it anytime you want. And this is something that you are doing strictly out of self-love. And if you remember that, I think it makes it easier to stick to it for the entirety of the 30 days, even with what's going on around you.
Restaurant chains. Which ones do you find, and I'll throw out a couple of my own local when you're done, which ones do you find make it possible to go to them and successfully eat Whole30 meals?
I don't do a ton of chains because we have some really awesome small local like restaurants in Salt Lake City, a lot of whom do Whole30 well, but like I eat at airports all the time. Almost every airport restaurant now has a gluten-free menu, which is a great place to start. If it's gluten-free, then you know you can at least exclude like that, and then you're asking questions about dairy or cooking oil. I think Chipotle has a couple meals that are compliant, and I think if you Google, we've got like a good list of resources or references. At most places, like I posted about 8, if you are going out for breakfast or brunch, that's really the easiest meal to Whole30. Here is a 100% guaranteed, they cannot mess this up, Whole30 breakfast or brunch. It's 3 poached eggs. Because they're in water, they're not, you have to, don't have to worry about cooking oil. It's a side of sliced tomatoes and a side of avocado. Boom. That doesn't look weird. Nobody's thinking it's a weird breakfast, but it's like guaranteed compliant. So I think doing your research ahead of time, looking at the menu, maybe calling the restaurant and seeing what you can and can't order. But I've done Whole30 on the road, and this was like years ago. And you can always find something that's compliant. It might not be the most exciting meal, but in that moment, the kind of social opportunity is way more important than what's actually on your plate.
The most challenging place I ever had was DFW, the Dallas airport, on Whole30. But it still worked. Yeah. A bunless burger with lemon and a lot of cheap mustard is Whole30 compliant. Yeah. Just
cool.
Fine.
Yeah.
Worked.
And it works. And you know you're always like carrying meat sticks and stuff on the plane anyway, right? You've yeah. always got like a meat stick in your purse, always.
And a Lara
or
bar.
Or your yep. bag. And a Lara yep. bar, sure. Yep.
The local chains, I'm sure lots of folks here are familiar with, that are really good on this are Cava. Not everything at Cava. You kind of got to look through it. As you said, gluten-free and Sweet Green are two really great places. One of the neat things about Cava and Sweet Green for those of us in Washington is we are used to being the last for every food trend. We're always behind. And Cava and Sweet Green are two local companies that have been so successful, you can actually now see them in New York.
Oh, nice.
Which gives us
well,
some
and you guys know
pride.
Territory Foods is here in Washington, D.C. They're Whole30 approved and they deliver, right? Delivery. Yeah. So you can order Whole30 approved meals right from Territory Foods and they will send them right to you. So that makes it like really fast and easy for you locals.
That's great. Okay, enough questions from me. We have two microphones set up here so folks can come forward and ask their own questions. A couple requests when you do, I would ask that please make it a question and tell us your name. So step on forward.
I am Elizabeth from Harrisonburg, Virginia. I'm on my second round. Question, how important is the healthy fat both during the 30 days and after? Because I find that to be very difficult.
It's difficult to eat enough healthy fat?
Yeah, why is this on my plate? It doesn't belong here.
Oh, interesting. Fat is so fun, you guys. Don't you? I think fat's so fun. It's what makes food taste good. It is really important. It's important from a satiety perspective. It's important from a macronutrient perspective. It's like what, you know, all your sex hormones are based on. So it's kind of important. But I think people, it's not like Atkins where it's just like a fat-a-palooza. It's just a like moderate portion of healthy fat with every single meal. And I think you'll find that helps with everything from energy. If we're trying to transition you from sugar burner to fat burner and being able to utilize fat both from your body fat and from your food as fuel, you've got to give it some of the fuel you're looking for it to utilize. But I don't think you have to do a ton. So we've got some recommendations in our meal template. A little bit of cooking oil and a little bit of whatever, a little drizzle of ranch dressing or your homemade mayo or olives or avocado, and you're good to go. I think that is the most kind of widely variable macronutrient. So if you find you're hungry all the time and your energy is dipping, you can try adding more fat and seeing if that works. If you're finding your meals are just like too satiating and you can't get through breakfast without, you know, feeling like you're not going to want lunch for hours and hours, maybe you're adding a little bit too much. So you can play around with it. But you don't ever really want to go too low in fat. That's where you start kind of seeing problems metabolically.
Thank you.
Hi, Melissa. My name's Kelly.
Hi.
I'm from the D.C. area, and my family during Thanksgiving was actually looking through the cookbooks that my mom and I had brought to help cook meals with, and we found that my grandparents were actually really questioning what it was we were doing and why it was something that they were going to be able to do, potato chips being my grandmother's like absolute vice in life, and she kept saying, this is crazy, I don't know how you do this, I don't know how you do this, I don't know how I could do it kind of mentality. And in the conversations I've had with that particular generation, it's been very hard to communicate. So is there anything that I can help her with, all of her particular ailments, to say, you really should try this and see how it goes for you without being really forceful about it?
Has anyone ever tried to make someone do something that they didn't think they needed to do? It's really hard. And so if your grandmother is expressing interest in it, like, I'd really like to do it, I can see the benefits of it, here's what's holding me back, right? I don't know what I would do without my potato chips. We tend to want to refute what sounds like a logical objection with more logic. Oh, well, okay, but if you really like this, you know, but your potato chips, but you're not doing it for 30 days, then maybe we can bake our own at home, or you can do this instead with a little bit of salt and a little bit of ghee. And what actually is probably happening here is that it is an emotional argument that will never be won by logic. So the question I would ask in that situation is like, Graham, what is making you nervous about this? What's making you anxious about this idea of giving up your potato chips? Like, what is it about it that's, you know, you sound almost scared. Like, what is it about it that's making you feel this way? If you can connect with somebody at that emotional level, like, I don't know what I'll do when I'm, you know, by myself at home, I use potato chips to keep me company, or whatever the answer is, if you can get to something that's on a little bit more of a deeper emotional level, one, it helps you to connect, which is really important, but two, you may actually be able to get around or past the fear or the worry. So that it's hard to make someone do something unless they think they need to do it, but if she's at that point of at least pre-contemplation, that's the conversation I would have, rather than the, like, alternative to potato chips.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm a huge fan. I'm Charles DeSantis. I'm at Georgetown University. I'm the chief benefits officer, and I also founded our wellness program for faculty and staff. And my husband and I have 4 kids, and last year we did Whole30 for, like, we kind of made it our lives. We did our first 30 days, and after like 4 months, we moved and went on a vacation, and we so fell off the wagon that it was like repossessed. I can't find it. So I'm sure I have a key. It's somewhere in the neighborhood. But I don't know how to shift from this mindset of having it all available to like having a lot of dramatic change at once and still staying focused. And, you know, we have 4 kids and all that blah, blah, blah. We all have the challenges here, right? So I don't know how to do that. And it totally took me off.
Have you read Food Freedom Forever?
No.
That's what that entire book is about, because your experience is not unique. What happens is that we do the Whole30 and we're talking about like addressing, looking at, evaluating decades often of unhealthy habits and maybe a dysfunctional relationship with food. That's really at the heart of a lot of what's going on with our food issues. And then we make this really sweeping, drastic change where I'm telling you what to eat for 30 days, which can feel very comforting to a lot of people, right? It takes a lot of the executive function and decision-making out of the kind of willpower center of the brain. And you just let me tell you what to eat for a while. And you look awesome and you feel awesome and you feel like you're back in control and it feels great. And then you do the reintroduction, which is kind of like a training wheel period where you get to bring some stuff back in, but you're going back to Whole30 for a few days in between, and that feels manageable. And then you're out in the real world and you've got to make your own decisions, and you have to make your own decisions about what's worth it for you. And do you really want it in this moment? And there's no blanket answer to that. Nothing is ever always worth it or never worth it. It's always very contextual. And in the face of temptation, it's very, very difficult to get yourself in that mind space of recognizing I can have anything I want, but do I really want it? And isn't going to be worth it. And if you're able to make that decision in the moment and you say, you know what, this isn't worth it, you don't feel deprived. You don't feel like you missed out. You were the one who decided. But you've got to get yourself to that place in the first place. And that's what Food Freedom Forever is all about. It's this 3-part plan, the third step of which is acknowledge when your healthy habits have started to slip and how to stay in that moment. Like, there are so many very specific in-the-moment success strategies for evaluating in the face of this temptation. Do I want it? Is it worth it? Isn't going to mess me up? So that's where I would recommend starting. I would recommend resetting. While you're resetting, read Food Freedom Forever so that you're staying entrenched in that growth mindset and then really practicing what you've learned. But understand that if you need to come back and do another Whole30 at some point because your habits have started to slip, it's not a failure. In fact, I think that's an amazing success of you acknowledging that you're not where you want to be and going back to something that you know has worked so well for you. I would say that's a rousing success.
I just had a neat little flashback, which is the other one of these author conversations I've done here is with Richard Thaler, the economist, who actually is the current Nobel Prize laureate in economics. And his work is all about things called choice architecture. His most famous book he co-authored is called Nudge. There is actually so much overlap between his work and the sort of stuff you're talking about, which is basically there are lots of little ways we can set up our choices that make our lives harder. And there are lots of little ways we can set up our choices that make our lives easier. And don't think that there's some neutral set of choice architecture, as he would say, right? Whether you're making the decisions or not about the kind of food you have around you, about whether you're going to exercise a lot, you are effectively making decisions that are going to have a huge influence on you. And so figure out a way to nudge yourself toward good stuff. Yeah. And there's so much of that there.
Hi, Melissa. My name's Mary. I'm from Gaithersburg, Maryland, and I'm currently in my fourth Whole30 over a period of about 3.5 years. And last year, after I read Food Freedom Forever, I actually did a Whole30 right after that. And I was very conscious of the reintroduction phase, especially on my third Whole30. And I learned a lot, and I know what I cannot eat, and I know what my trigger is. And, you know, me and red wine, boy, we... But, so my question is, now that I'm in my fourth one, after the holidays, needed a reset, so on and so forth, I have questions about what the reintroduction is going to look like this time. In that, you know, I know that dairy and I don't agree. I know that sugar and especially that red wine don't agree. The other stuff, the grains and the legumes, not so much. Do I really need to go through that again, or do I take that knowledge from the last time and go out in the wide world?
That's a great question. You need to go through reintroduction every single time, exactly by the book, except don't reintroduce something that you know already isn't working well for you. Okay. So there's no need to bring red wine back in again and like kick yourself in the head again that it's still like, oh no, still doesn't work for me, right? There's no need to do that. But what I will say is even after my like sixth and seventh and eighth Whole30, I would bring stuff back in that 30 days ago I would have told you was worth it. Hummus is a really good one. I used to eat hummus all the time, and it was totally fine for me. And then I did a Whole30, and I brought it back in, and I was like, oh, maybe it's not totally fine. That's interesting. I never noticed that it had this little subtle effect. And sometimes it's psychological. It took me a long time to really come to, like, Jesus with the idea that tortilla chips were food with no breaks, and I should just never have them in the house. But that wasn't until, like, my sixth or seventh Whole30. And I think... we just continue to learn. We continue to really refine that relationship with food. What was worth it a year ago may not be worth it today, or vice versa. And so I think the reintroduction is a very important space for you to continually evaluate the stuff that you've been eating that you may have kind of just like grandfathered in as okay. Give it another shot and just make sure. Every time you do a Whole30 and you eliminate and reintroduce, it allows you the opportunity to dial it in even more specifically. You know, so maybe one glass of white wine has been okay, and maybe in this reintroduction you realize that if you stop at half a glass, it's actually way, way better. So use the opportunity that you're given, but don't bring stuff back in that you've already evaluated as, like, no bueno.
Thanks. Hi, Melissa. My name is Anne. I'm from Chevy Chase. I'm in round two in about 2.5 years. My question is about the podcast. You've talked on some of your podcasts, and Gretchen Rubin talked about it. And even if you didn't do a regular podcast, maybe you could do 30 episodes.
Did Gretchen put you up to this?
She did not.
So the question, yeah. So I've talked. Gretchen Rubin has invited me to do a podcast under her imprint. Gretchen and I are friends. I am a huge admirer of her work. I think she is so brilliant and so smart. And there's so much overlap between what she does with her four tendencies and what we do here. I do want to do a podcast, and I think I've been writing books, so I haven't been able to focus on it, but I think this is the year, and I think it's going to be very, you know, I've gone back and forth with the team about, like, oh, it needs to have a theme, and it needs to have segments, and it needs to have that. That's not me. I just want to, like, get up and talk and have these conversations and bring people in and kind of share information, so I think it's going to be way more casual, but yeah, it will happen this year. You can go tell Gretchen now. Thank you, though, for the push. I appreciate it.
Hello, my name is Mary, and I'm doing my second Whole30. I found out about Whole30 in December of 15, ordered the books, and then did my first one about middle of January. And my question is on the reintroduction, is really understanding or how to really listen, some tips for how to really listen to your body and knowing. I know that there were a few things that when I reintroduced the last time, that I knew, gee, I'm feeling this in my gut, but I'm struggling a little bit with when I get to reintroduction, how to really understand what my body is telling me.
That's a great question, Mary. So I always talk about reintroduction as a lifelong process, and not everything is going to be as black or white or as, like, directly correlated as I ate this and my belly got super bloated and I had, like, a really tough, you know, digestive night or something like that. Sometimes the effects are far more subtle. Sometimes they're physical. Sometimes they're psychological. Sometimes the impact accumulates. So when I eat bread for one meal, I don't really notice much of anything. If I eat it like 2 or 3 days in a row, it goes downhill really fast. So what I like to say is when you're doing your reintroduction, make sure you're taking those 2 or 3 days in between each reintroductory food group to really let things settle down and evaluate. Even if you're just like suspecting, like, you know, I had like a really tough emotional day today. I wonder if it was related to this bread that I ate. Just like note it. And then the next time you decide that bread is worth it and you really want it and you eat it, ask yourself after, did I have that same reaction? This is how I noticed that when I eat too much gluten plus sugar, it makes me sad. It sounds weird, and I don't know that I would have put that together had I not done it a bunch of times and then made the kind of connection, drew the parallel between how I was feeling and what I ate. And now I can very consciously and deliberately make that connection, and now it makes it not very worth it for me. But I would say the reintroduction, the actual 10-day, is only the start of your evaluating whether this food continues to be worth it for you or not.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Rick. I have a question about your exercise regimen and how you seem very fit, so you must be doing something that I'm not doing. So could you talk about that? How often do you exercise? What kinds of exercises do you do? And isn't it really important? I mean, it's not prescribed, but you can't just do it on foods alone, can you?
So if anyone follows me on Instagram, you know that I'm probably doing a lot of things that he's not doing in the gym. I do a lot of weird stuff. I have a background in fitness. I used to own a CrossFit gym. I traveled with Jeff Martone to coach CrossFit kettlebells for a couple years. My fitness experience is extensive. I've done a lot of yoga, kettlebells, bodyweight stuff, you know, big picking up heavy stuff. And I do have a love for being in the gym and moving my body and being passionate about it. That having been said, I think you will see a lot of amazing synergistic benefits if you Whole30 and move your body, whatever that looks like. Maybe it's a commitment to going for walks or yoga classes or getting your steps in, whatever that looks like. But if you only had capacity to focus on one big change right now, I would 100% of the time always urge you to start with your diet. That is where you get the most bang for your buck. And habit research shows that the brain really can only prioritize one major habit shift or one major goal at a time. So if you're starting this January Whole30 and it's your first Whole30, now's not the time to get into like a 30-day yoga challenge or whatever that might look like. If, as is very commonly observed, you're doing the Whole30 and a couple weeks in, your energy is up and your self-confidence is up and you're feeling great, looking great, and you're like, what else can I do? That might be a good time to get into the gym or a yoga class or find a walking buddy or start hiking or skiing or snowboarding or cross-country skiing or whatever that looks like. Now would be a great time, right, to get that extra energy into just the very mellow start of what could be a new healthy habit once your Whole30 is over and you're living your food freedom. And that's going to look different for everybody. I just encourage people to do whatever makes you happy and whatever you feel like is sustainable. So if you hate running, don't start running. But maybe you can find a group to go walking with or hiking. I think walking is like the most underrated form of exercise. I think everybody should be walking more. But yeah, I think it's important. I don't think it's as important as food in terms of making these, seeing these really big transformations. But I do want you to go about it kind of organically. And if you're on a Whole30 right now, that really just focus on that for now until something, the either energy or inspiration comes very naturally.
In my experience, which is consistent with what you're saying, incremental changes in exercise are just a lot easier than incremental changes in food, right? Incremental changes in food, I think, are often doomed, which is why your work has been so popular and helpful for so many people. But the idea of I'm gonna instead of going to my nearest metro stop, I'm gonna walk one metro stop and then get on the metro. It's not that hard to dial that stuff up just little bits.
Yeah, and so. I know, like, it sounds. It almost sounds so like lame or trite to say like walk more, take the stairs, but like that stuff all right. adds up. Not only from a physical perspective, from the perspective of I'm a healthy person who takes the stairs. And that growth mindset really sticks with you into thinking about, okay, well, if I'm a healthy person because I take the stairs, what else would a healthy person do? Maybe I would take the next metro stop. Maybe I won't take a cab at all. Maybe I'll walk the whole way. So yeah, I think it's very important.
Hi, I'm Karen. This is my fifth Whole30 in 5 years. And I know in the very beginning, no one knew what it was. No one understood why I was so picky at the grocery store. It was really hard to find things. You had to order a lot of it online. But obviously from the crowd here, it's changed a lot in those times. And you can find things at the grocery store now. And I know you mentioned that some of these companies have changed to make them more accessible to Whole30. But are there any plans to work with companies directly to do that? or the food industry as a whole, because the first couple of years, it was shocking to me how much sugar is added to things. You couldn't find salad dressing. You couldn't find tomato sauce, things like that. But it's really great now that all of this is out there, but there's still a long way to go, especially with the restaurant industry. I was that hermit the first year I did it. I didn't go out anywhere. And it's, you know. So
I think we are on the precipice of some continued major changes. Again, when I, like little old Melissa with her little old Whole30 program, like gets an email from Applegate saying, like, we changed our bacon. Do you guys want to talk? I'm like, yes, I do want to talk. That's amazing. So I think what we're seeing is just this consumer demand for more transparency, for fewer additives. Like, why are you putting sugar in this thing that doesn't need any sugar? I think that Whole30 is kind of at the forefront of that, because we are so well organized and we are so vocal and we are so loyal and we are so passionate, and we're not afraid to walk into our Whole Foods and say, why isn't there a sugar-free salad dressing at the salad bar? So I think that's huge. Doing stuff at a bigger level, I've talked about, you know, getting into hospitals, getting into schools and making changes. It's so hard because so much of their funding and their mission is all tied in with the USDA and dollars, and it, like, even someone like Jamie Oliver, who did amazing things for the school system, it's just a huge challenge. My approach is just kind of like doing it the way we're doing it. It's like one person at a time, one company at a time. Applegate makes these changes. Food News, which is a trade industry publication, writes about it. Other companies go, well, if Applegate's doing it, we should probably do it too. And then we're seeing changes there. And, you know, Target is saying to my Tin Star Foods Ghee, like, we want to stock you, but I want the Whole30 label on the front of your item. And I'm like, cool, we can do that. So I think we're starting to see those changes. And I'm kind of just about doing it from like the ground up.
Because I think we're fortunate in the area that we're in. We have Whole Foods, we have Wegmans, we have Trader Joe's, we have places that will stock this stuff. But for people that are out really far out in the rural area, they don't have those options. So
yeah, but you can find new Primal marinades at Walmart now.
That's awesome.
I mean, that's amazing, right? So yeah, I think even more and more normal grocery stores are getting the message.
That's great.
For sure.
The sugar thing really is, for people who haven't done it, it's one of the most eye-opening things. Take 20 minutes and walk around the supermarket and look. Chicken stock, smoked salmon, bacon, and deli turkey. I love sugar. I mean, my children are here. They will attest to the fact that I sneak ice cream when I think they're not looking. But you don't need sugar in tomato sauce and all this good stuff.
It's true.
Yeah.
Somebody tweet that right now. New York Times, I love sugar.
Hi there. My name is Zuzana. I'm on my fourth Whole30 now. And I think my question builds on that. You know, they say everything in D.C. is about politics. And I was really shocked on my first Whole30, like, just how bad the food was. Like, I learned a lot about myself, but I also learned a lot about the food industry. And I was wondering if, in addition to these grassroots efforts that you're describing, if we also sort of need to get our politicians on board, and if you have given any thought to that. Because nutrition policy just isn't high on people that we elect's agendas. And I was wondering, you know, how do we put the spotlight on this other than just using our wallets at the grocery store?
So, I mean, you're asking me to take on a fight that is like so much bigger than anything I could ever imagine, right? Voting with your dollars, I think, is an enormous and impactful way to send a message. It's just very difficult to compete with food lobbies and industry and big business and big pharma. I will continue to just say that from my approach, we're just doing it from the ground up. I'm not trying to make, there are people who are doing amazing things. My friend Diana Rogers, who's a registered dietitian, is making a documentary basically dispelling this myth that, like, if you eat meat, you hate the world and yourself and animals, right? She's making this amazing documentary, and I've participated in funding that. But so we're trying to do some things from a variety of levels. But, like, I wouldn't know the first thing about how to change the food industry other than continuing to see more and more people in this room every single time I come out for a talk, and having you talking to people about it, and you talking to people. And then one person doing the Whole30 is actually the head chef at a hospital, and he's changing their hospital menu to be more Whole30 compliant, and people are loving it. Cool. Like, I just read that story. We just published it. So that's how it's going to happen from my perspective. I don't have the street cred or the resources or the clout to do anything at a higher level, but I think what we're doing is really good.
if you are interested in the politics, I would add that I think there's a lot of energy around soda taxes around the country. And I'll let you be quiet about this without implying that you're endorsing it or not. But there's a lot of energy around soda taxes. After failing and failing and failing because of the huge amounts of money that Big Soda spent on it, there now are a handful that have passed. And while soda taxes don't solve all of the problems, soda really is just liquid sugar that's injected into people, and for a lot of people it is the number one source of empty calories, and soda taxes work. We've seen that in Mexico. So if any of you are interested in getting involved, you can Google about that, and believe me, the public health advocates trying to get soda tax passed would love just a little bit of your money to fight the huge amounts of money that Coke and Pepsi spend to basically promulgate dishonesty about this.
Hi, my name's Courtney. I'm a clinical social worker in Kennett Square, Pennsylvania. And most of my community, the patients I work with, and my friends speak Spanish. So I'm just curious to know if there's any plans to have the books translated into Spanish.
Such good news. I just got the contract from Penguin in Mexico to translate the Whole30 book into Spanish.
All right.
I have been fighting for this for you for a year, and I don't know why it has taken so long to find a publisher to translate this into Spanish, what everybody's asking me for, and I think it would do so much good in that community where, you know, maybe your parents or grandparents do speak English or your clients speak English, but like having it in your native language would be so much better. So that is in the works and it's coming, and I'll be able to announce that soon. I don't know when it will be published. It generally takes a little while for the translation, but yeah, it's coming. Awesome. And we would love to do that. I mean, the book has been published into a number of languages, but like Spanish is just a no-brainer for me, and I don't know why it's been so hard. So thank you.
Great, thank you.
Thanks for the great question.
Hi, my name is Joanne Melendez, and I'm originally from Puerto Rico. And I just wanted to ask, I'm sure there's a lot of us here, once we've done the Whole30 and we're reintroducing and we've gone past that and we're just trying to live our day-to-day, what do you do? What goes on exactly in your head that makes you think, okay, let me not have that ice cream? Like, what? Because ice cream and donuts are like the best thing in the world for me. But what goes on exactly in your head? What do you tell yourself? How do you coach yourself through maybe not eating something once you've actually are just trying to live a healthy lifestyle?
So because I did my first Whole30 in 2009. I've got, you know, almost 9 years of experience living it. So that goes a long way in me having a much healthier relationship with food. I think one of the things that helps me is that I am brutally honest with myself. Like, I call myself on my own crap, where it's like, is this going to be worth it? No. Do I want to eat it anyway? Yes. Am I willing to pay the consequences? And the answer is yes or no. I think I've done so many Whole30s in and out that I've got a lot of experience knowing what's going to be worth it and isn't, dialed down to like one glass of white wine is okay, two glasses not okay. Or bread on this one day is okay. Like when I was in Norway, there was some delicious fresh baked bread at some of these restaurants, and it was like, well, I ate it yesterday and I ate it the day before, I can't eat it today. So part of it is just the practice. It is like doing the practice. Part of it is messing up. Part of it is like saying, I knew that wasn't gonna be worth it and I ate it anyway and it felt like crap, but not beating myself up for it, understanding that it was a really valuable learning lesson. I no longer have any guilt or shame around what I eat or don't eat. There's no morality in that for me. Even if I make a mistake, even if I eat something when I know I don't want it, even if I find myself, you know, hungry kind of with the tortilla chips, like it's like, oh man, that was dumb. I won't do that again. How can I be more mindful around it? And I'm very conscious about trying to connect. Usually it's like, what emotional state was I in, or what physical state was I in? Like right now I'm on book tour, I'm underslept and over traveled, and this is where I want to like crave sugar, where I want to like get on an airplane with a bag of M&Ms and just like fall face first into them. And I'm aware of that. So I'm like, okay, cool. I'll make sure I have all my meat sticks and all my other food. I've got a good book. I've got my headphones. I have my airplane playlist. Like that's what I'm going to do to not fall face first, because I know I'm very kind of prone to these cravings right now. So planning and preparation are still involved, but a lot of it just comes with the practice and repetition. That's it. It's like the life experience of it.
Great. Thank you.
What are the best meat sticks?
I'm in love with the new DNX bars. Have you guys tried them? DNX bar just reformulated so that all five of their flavors are Whole30 compliant, and they're like a little mini meal. They're delicious. Epic has some awesome Whole30 approved bars. Chomp Snack Sticks has some awesome ones. Wild Zora is great. I like to mix them up so I don't get too burnt out on any one. Yep. I travel with so much meat, David. So much meat.
Hi.
I can't tell what I'm talking. I'm Rachel. I've done a couple Whole30s, and I'm a personal trainer and also into strength training myself. And I know you have a background in sports nutrition. So something that we get a ton of questions on is like pre and post exercise nutrition when you're eating a Whole30 or a more paleo style diet. So what are your thoughts on that?
So pre-workout is very highly variable. I think I've played around a lot with eating before I work out, not eating before I work out, eating before I hike, but not before I do yoga. So a lot of it is just kind of trial and error. We make some general recommendations, and it starts with food, a little bit of protein, a little bit of fat. You don't necessarily need carbohydrate before you're going to do your like 20-minute CrossFit Metcon. You've got plenty stored. So it can be a good signal to your body that like exercise is coming, and it's cool to like let some fuel out for that. Post-workout, I think there's been like this huge emphasis on post-workout. Like, you know, if you want to make any gains at all, you've got to get your meal in within 20 minutes and it's got to be right away. And we used to say that. We used to be pretty dogmatic about it. Like, bring your post-workout meal to the gym with you and eat your like salmon and sweet potato right away. The way I think about it now is like, no one's paying me to exercise. And it's better to make sure that I get all my calories in and that I'm fueling my nutrition. But like, if I don't get home for about a half hour and then make myself a normal breakfast, like, it's fine. It's not actually impacting my fitness in any way. I like the idea of something post-workout based on protein, maybe carbohydrate, depending on whether you did a high-intensity session, you did burn a lot of carbohydrate in your session. But it doesn't necessarily have to be immediately, and real food is always best. And that's just kind of what I say. And then what you choose to do after your Whole30 is up to you. Reintroduce the whey protein, see if it works for you, and if it does and you want to use that post-workout, I have no issue with that. That's your food freedom.
My name's Abraham, and I have a question.
Okay. How old are you, Abraham?
I'm 9.
Okay.
Oh, how many times have you done the hurt? Wait.
Did you already answer this question?
Maybe. You can answer this. Did you already, wait. So how many times have you done the whole 30?
So I've done the whole 30, Abraham, probably about 8 times. I kind of like lost track at one point counting. But I think it's like 8 times. But I do a lot of what I call mini Whole30s in between. So I'll give you an example. I'm going to get back from this book tour. I'm going to be really tired. I'm going to be really run down. I'm going to want to get back to feeling my best. I'll probably do the Whole30 for like 7 or 8 days when I get home and really keep it squeaky clean. And that's going to help me kind of recharge and get back to a place where I feel like my energy is good and I'm sleeping good and I'm back in the gym and back in my routine. And that will be good enough for me. I haven't done a full Whole30 in about 2 years because I haven't needed it. And the point of the Whole30 is to like learn how to live your food freedom. And if I've been successfully living my food freedom for the last 2 years, then like, awesome, good for me. Don't go back and do it unless you need it. But I will say I've done it probably 7 or 8 times. I'm pretty good at it by now.
Thank you, Abraham.
Thank you, Abraham.
My name is Abraham. I'm Abraham's dad. And I also have a question. I want to talk to you about diversity, both income diversity and gender diversity. If you look in this room, there's not that many minorities, and there's also not that many men. And so when I'm promoting the Whole30 program, this is my 5th time going, and also I brought my whole office through it.
I know who you are.
Yes. And so when I'm talking to people about it, I do find that when I'm talking to men, or even when I'm talking to individuals who don't have the income, they look at it as a burden to do the program. And what I challenge them to say is like, would you rather invest on your health now or invest in your health later? And that still is an argument that's very challenging. It's that logical versus emotional that you just spoke about earlier. So what tools, I know that they have a coaching program, but even with the coaching program, that still is a financial burden, that not burden, but investment on someone that may not have the income.
Yeah. I love following Abraham on Instagram. You like, it's so fun to watch your journey and your shirts. he takes pictures with his shirts on Instagram. It's fantastic, right? Yes. So as to income, I will say this, and this is what I remind people, the entirety of the Whole30 program is available for free. The entirety. You can, and it's not like, oh, we're going to give you half, but then you have to buy all this crap to get the other half, like the important half. The program rules, a ton of PDF downloads, the forum is free, all of our blog articles are free. I'm writing a newsletter every 2 times a month that's free. I'm writing articles for our website. We have social media feeds that are incredibly engaged and active. Like, the only thing you have to spend money on if you want to do the Whole30 is your food. And you're going to eat food anyway. So I've tried to make it as accessible as possible from that perspective. And even our coaches, we have two Whole30 certified coaches here in DC, Dana and Kate. They're up front in case you guys want to ask questions. But they're giving a lot of stuff away for free too. If you look at their Instagram feeds and their social media, like they're offering tips and hacks and recipes, and like there's so much stuff. So we try to make it as accessible as possible. We're trying to increase representation on our social media feeds and on our blog. People of color and men and older generation, we're trying. I've asked the question a number of times, like I know guys are doing Whole30, why aren't more of them showing up?
Right.
And the answer I'm getting is that, you know, they don't turn to social media for support as often. They're not talking about their emotional relationship with food as outright, perhaps. But we're trying to, and I think if you look at the Whole30 Instagram feed, you will see our commitment to increasing diversity and representation. I'm having conversations with the lovely man named Jarrett Hill. He's a writer. He speaks a lot about, a journalist. He speaks a lot about increasing diversity. And when I have questions about our community and how we can promote and how we can bring more people in, he's been a great resource for me. So we're actively working on it. If there's anything I can do to help you spread your mission, please let me know, because you've been a joy to follow.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
oh,
Abraham.
Oh, yeah. What's your Instagram, Abraham? Tell them, please.
It's AskAW, so A-S-K-A-W.
Thank you.
It's really fun. Thank you.
Okay.
I'll be quick. I'm Allison. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland. And first, I just wanted to plug the Whole30 Day by Day book. If this was a thing when we first were doing Whole30, it would be a game changer. So please just plug in the book. It's amazing. And my day seven is already better than any other day seven I had. My question for you is, you seem and are one of the busiest women I look at from afar, right? And I only recently got up courage to DM you to say, Melissa, I'm having this problem, or I'm on my way to see you. And to my surprise, you responded like within minutes. And I was like, holy crap, like this is amazing. So I'm fangirling a little bit. But my question to you is, I know that you do hiking as like your thing to kind of decompress and get away. What are some things that you do for yourself in these times where you're super busy and doing so much for other people?
Yeah. So, I mean, if anyone DM'd me, I hit you back.
Yeah.
Because connecting with you is like literally the most important part of what I do. It's like the best part of my job. It's the best part of like, yeah, because the Whole30 is really all about you guys. So I am a huge advocate for self-love, and I think that looks like any number of things. Last night it involved room service, eating a burger in my bed by myself and talking to exactly zero persons, because that's what I needed. This morning it was doing my morning routine here in DC and not telling a single one of you what I did on Instagram story. I needed that just for me. Sometimes it's saying no to the idea of a podcast or an opportunity when I know that I need the time for myself. When I'm home, you know, I'm always buying myself flowers. I buy myself flowers like once a week, and I love that. So I'm a huge advocate for just like finding these little things that you can do within your day that are just for you, that remind you that you're present and you're grounded, and that you are, you know, worthy of that kind of care and attention. Because if I burn out, I'm not any good to any of you. So that's kind of, if you go to the hashtag Melissa Self Loves, which don't be dirty, it sounds dirty now in retrospect, but Melissa Self Loves, I talk about all of the ways in which you can very practically practice this idea of self-love, which can often be very airy in concept.
I would add one thing. We were talking before, and you said you got 13 hours of sleep last night.
Oh, yeah, 13.
And you sounded so pleased about that.
Yes, I did. I was thrilled with it. I know what I need to do to take care of me. So whether it's like skipping the gym in favor of sleep, or maybe it's saying no to the social obligation or no to the phone. You know, my mom the other day wanted to talk on the phone, and I was like, no, Mom, I have zero capacity for that. And she was like, cool, can we text? And I was like, yep, and then you're good. So, yeah.
Hi. My name's Lindsay. I'm actually, I don't know if I heard, I'm like on my first Whole30. I technically started on the second because black eyed peas were a thing and I really wanted them because they're delicious. But with that being said, I did try to cut out dessert and alcohol on the first with my boyfriend's family. And it's not so much about talking to people about why I'm doing this that really matters to me, but I have a tendency to be like, get the heck out of here. I'm doing what I want. Like, and a lot of people like react to me as like, why are you on a diet? And I'm like, I'm not, because I'm not doing this to lose weight. I'm doing it because I want to be like, it's like a meditation thing for me. So I guess in practice, I wanted to see if you had any advice for like how you address people who are really, really not attacking, but like how do you prevent yourself from being defensive? And like, that's like really hard for me because I have a tendency to be like,
so a couple of tips there. One really easy thing, they like to bring this out over food, like when once you roll your lunch out or once the food is on the table or once you've ordered. And like a really easy thing is, oh, I hate talking about food over food. Can you like, let's talk about this after, and then immediately change the subject. I hate talking about food over who, ask me about it after. How was the movie you saw last night? And immediately divert the subject. Another really good tactic is just having that super short elevator pitch, like, oh, this isn't a diet. I've actually been like really struggling with allergies and I'm playing around with like whether I have any food sensitivities. How was the movie you saw last night? There's a lot of diversion in there, having that short answer. I think the biggest thing to remember is that it is never about you. You have the capacity to make people feel bad about what they're doing just by rolling up with your like healthy Whole30 lunch. Yeah. And it's not about you. It is about the fact that they perhaps recognize that they could be better in their own lives and they're not doing anything about it and they get judgmental or criticizing or preachy or whatever. Right. So I think it's just if you can remember that, that will help you to not be defensive. Like this is it's not about you. Right. And then making sure that you're not having those conversations like over food, keep it as brief as possible and then change the subject.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, it was really late. They were like, why are you not having dessert? I don't want it.
Yeah, you can also just say like, just not feeling it tonight. Yeah. No, not tonight.
luckily there was something in it that I didn't want. So it actually was kind of easy for me. Yeah,
great. Perfect.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay, a couple thank yous before we end up. First of all, this bookstore is really an enormous resource for our whole community. So I just wanted to take a moment so all of us can say thank you to the folks who work here, can say thank you to Brad and to Lissa. And this is me talking, not them, but I love to browse here. Just remember, browsing doesn't pay for the lights and the people who work here. Buy a book here. Second of all, let's all say thank you to Melissa.